Hello. It's working. Hello, everybody. Good morning. So welcome to the 14th edition of the Blender Conference. So I'm very, very excited that we have this highlight of the year again. I think everybody is feeling like having a good conference as well, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's start. Okay, what I'm going to talk about very quickly is the development, what we did in the last year, a little bit about the roadmap, projects we are doing at the moment, and some notes about the Blender Conference. But first, we do the warming up, right? So we have to move a little bit and show where everybody is. There's also another room. I can't see all their hands, but we couldn't fit everybody in the Bali theater. So there's also a stream next door. So hi, guys, next door. Oh, there they are. Hey, that's awesome. Hey. Good. So my first question to the audience is, where are people from? I want to know where are people flying into the Netherlands from. But first, like, how many Dutch people dare to go to the London conference? Show me hands, Dutch people. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That's not bad. So is there any Dutch person living in Amsterdam? Amsterdam Dutch people. I know you guys, I know you. Almost. Ah, that's him. Okay, I know you guys. So we have a Blender Institute in Amsterdam, and we have Friday weeklies. You can always visit, mail me, and you can have a visit in the Blender studio. So other countries, Germany, for example, our neighbors. Aha, so that's a little bit more. That's good. So is there a separation between like West and East still over there, or? So how many people are from the former East? Ah, that's nice. So the Westerns are the more common visitors, like former Western Germany is a little bit more. Ah, no, it's almost the same. Good. So I'm from France. La France. Très bien. Good. And Belgium, of course. Where is Belgium? Ah, there's one. There's, yeah. Cool. The UK, are the British here? We need more British people here. Irish people, maybe? Hey, that's one. Oh, whoa, three Irish. That's awesome. So, let me go a little bit to the South, Spain, Portugal. Ah, famous person from Spain. Welcome. Portugal, at least one, I know. So, Italy, come on, Italians. Ah, that's quite a lot. Yeah. So, let me go up north to Switzerland. Switzerland, oh, that's nice. So I really need to know my geography. So, we have Austria, of course. Oh, Poland. Ooh. And then in Czechia, and Slovakia, and Hungary, Romania. I mean, let's go. Who lives? Oh, Russia, of course, Russia. That's a big one. And there is Belarusia, even at least two. Yes, I know that part. So, who lives in Europe? And I didn't mention his country yet. Huh? Where are you living?
Ukraine.
Denmark, of course, sorry, Denmark. And the whole Scandinavian, Finland. Finland, yes. And there. Norway. And Sweden, we had that. That's awesome. Okay, so we have all of Europe now. Iceland, wait, there's one Icelandic person here at least. But he's still getting his talk finished for today. Good. Let's go to Asia. People from the big continent of Asia, including Japan. Well, that's a long trip. So we're on Japan. Ah, Thailand. Yes.
India.
Awesome. More? Indonesia, maybe? Ah, there's one. okay, good, welcome. Australians. We have Australians. Wow, one, two. Where are you from? But not very close. No. That's what I know still, right? Okay, so we go to Africa. The whole continent of Africa. Anyone? No Africans today. Ah. Then we go to the other side of the world. The South America. South America. Costa Rica. That's Central America. Right? Central America, Costa Rica one. That's awesome. Two Costa Ricans. Three Costa Ricans. Can we get four? Okay, the Mexico maybe. No? That's also Central America. United States. Quite a lot. Good. Canadians. Do we have Canadians here today? One. Excellent. So then I think I had the world, right? The North Pole, the South Pole. Ah, Greenland, that is part of Denmark, you know. Or the that's much. Good, so thank you. Before I forget, so one other thing, so I would like to know your occupation. So how many people are students here? Students, okay. Or people who teach, teachers. So you can talk to the students here and so how many people would call themselves an artist? Or a developer? Ah, that's a lot. Good. So how many people would say that they are freelancer? Actively looking for jobs too? No, most of the freelancers are busy working. So how many people are hiring other people? And looking for people. Hey, look at that. So make sure that you get heard. Tomorrow, Saturday, we have open podium, open stage, and you can still submit a 5-minute talk. So if you have a big plan and you need people to work on it, you can also have your 5 minutes of fame tomorrow. So how many people are scientists working for universities? Wow. Researchers. Good. How many people work in a normal job in a studio or another company, getting full-time paid and stuff? Huh? Or how would you call yourself an architect? Architects, we always have lots of architects here. Yeah? Or designers, industrial design. Or visualization stuff. Well, that's a little bit more. So then, what are you guys using Blender for? Are you using Blender for visual effects or for film? Ah. Or are you using it for games and interactive 3D? Or use it for animation? So, or in general visualization, scientific visualization, that kind of things. Yeah. How many people develop Blender Python scripts? Oh, that's also a lot. And the really hardcore Blender C developers, C and C++. They have yellow badges, people who are working on Blender, so everybody can bother them because they had three badges. So it's important to look at the badge. If you see a yellow badge, that person is there for you. So you can talk to those people and say, hey, I want you to do something for me. That's the deal. So, yeah, and then the last one is, of course, so for who is this the first Blender conference? Yeah, so it's usually like 30%. Yeah, awesome. Who has the second conference? And then we start counting up. The third. You still remember who did 4 conferences? 5? 6? 7, 8, 9, 10 or more. Who are the really diehards here? 10 or more conferences. But There might be even one with 11, 12, 13, 14 conferences. That's one at least. That's Elsa. Andy should be there, but he's somewhere else. Ah, there. Yeah, that's Andy. And wasn't Wiebren also the 14th?
How many are there?
But he's not there yet. He's coming later, I think. Oh, good. Oh, thank you. Moving on with my talk. So, how many people don't know what Blender is? One or two? So that's usually, I skip this whole part. You have 3 days to find out what Blender is. But what I usually like to confirm in every talk is just the simple thing about what is it, what we do here, and what is the goal of the Blender Foundation. It's very important to have that in mind, especially now there are discussions about the Blender market or people getting paid for Blender development. So how does this work with the whole idea that we are working on a free and open source complete 3D creation suite for independent artists and small teams? I think in this little thing, we have the goal of the project. So even though sometimes people get paid or charge money for things, the money thing is not the goal. The money thing is the means. The goal is what we do here. In the end, we want to have a complete creation suite. Not for 80% or for 85%, but my goal is to have the full pipeline from start to end covered in open source and free software. I think everybody, also people who sell their services, who sell things on Blender Market, I think they all support this goal. Now, a little bit about Blender development. In the past year, we did 5 releases, even though 2.7.2 was around the conference, and 2.7.6 is also around the conference. But we've been busy, so every 2-3 months a release, and shitloads of things are being added. I'm not going over all of it. I think people who follow Blender know a little bit what this means and what we are working on. What I would like to show is a little bit an example of what I'm so proud of about how Blender development works. Turn the volume a little bit down. What you see here is all done in the Blender viewport. This is the Grease Pencil feature in Blender. And many people might know it, but it started as an annotation tool for people to have quick notes in the viewport. And then suddenly people started using it for things like storyboarding. And then the developer said, oh, then I can support them with some animation tools. And then it ended up like this, which looks like an animation. It looks like a well-done production. But everything is still 3D. It is a 3D drawing and it's 3D lines. And you can edit everything as if you are working in a 3D environment. In a half a minute, you can see what I'm talking about. So when I showed this at SIGGRAPH last August, the people coming by from DreamWorks and Pixar and Disney and all those studios, and especially story artists, they freak out when they see this. But they're used to do drawing and storyboards and story development. But now you can combine the whole story development for designing and drawing with like camera layout and scene design, where you make a complete animatic of your film inside of Blender. And especially when this clip was shown, people were like, huh? What? I still don't get it. What is it? Is it 3D lines? And then Daniel does this trick. Start selecting things and moving it around. What? It's a 3D line. That's just 3D line. We're going to do this. So for us, it's very normal. For me, it's very normal. But this interaction of our users and developers, that's what totally amazing. And the next is a good example as well. Well done. Yeah, and it's of course the thing why we do open movies in Blender Institute. So it's about bringing users and developers together in an environment and make them work on things. For me, that is still the thing that makes Blender the most special open source project on the planet. Because we really do work with users. It's not about listening to users, it's about working with them. Working with them in their daily practice, look at what they are doing, and involve the users in the making process. This is also something you can only do as an open source project, because you have to share the ideas about the code and make it open so that users can interact with it. So, more about the Gooseberry project later in the conference. So what is going on in Blender development right now? There is some Cycles OpenCL being wrapped up still. Unsure where this goes, but we will hear about that later. There's OpenVDB for volume caching, asset management. There's also a talk about that. Yeah, and we have developers via Blender Development Fund and Blender Institute hired for plenty of topics, especially bug fixing. So it was a little bit of a problem last year when we were planning like 276, and I thought we have to do 277 and 278 and 279, and it keeps dragging on. And it feels like we spend too much time on things that are not so exciting anymore. It becomes like a corporate environment with support systems and procedures and reviews. So we spend too much time on all the overhead or on code reviewing, or it becomes extremely complicated to get one small feature in Blender. Why is that? It used to be like 2 hours work, and suddenly it's like 5 weeks of negotiations and talks and reviews and things to get something done. And it's also sometimes very unclear about why something gets into Blender, or who decides, or what is this flow? How do we find out what to do in Blender? So it was time to, I thought, to take a little break and say, well, let's stop with this whole cycle of making small releases every 2 months, but take a break and think about what to do in, for example, 1 year or maybe even longer, and look at how we can make a big leap again to solve all those problems. I have a talk up in the afternoon about 2.8. we'll be going a little bit more into detail, but we'll talk about the 2.5 things, what works for it, what doesn't work for it. We should be feeling free to remove lots and lots of old code radically, which sometimes might be a bit painful for some users. And we have to empower more people to decide, to work, that we don't have long procedures to do things. And I mentioned it, the workflow project. So what is workflow? Workflow is everything that starts from when you open Blender until you deliver something in the final for the client or for yourself online. A couple of key topics of the viewport project are listed here. I think many people know this already or not, but you can hear me talking about this afternoon at 3 o'clock. Other projects. We have the Blender Network. There will be a session about this at the conference as well. A network is to connect professionals. It's the official Blender Foundation partnership program, you could call it. It's about people who are for hire or people who produce or who have studios. We would like to invite them to become more visible. Because one of the big bottlenecks in the Blender universe and our Blender ecosystem is still that we have a lot of demand, but we can't fill the gap of that demand. Studios want to have consultants. People want to have help getting Blender working in pipelines. And we need a place where you can find trusted developers or trainers or teachers or consultants. We have our Blender Development Fund. The Development Fund is, at the moment, really keeping Blender up and running. After we have 3 developers full-time, the top developers, Campbell and Sergey and Bastien, really good people, but they are working like full-time on reviewing and bugs and doing the support. But doing that makes Blender stable and working really, really well. And they got paid by the Development Fund, mostly. So there are 300 members bringing in money, and we have some bigger sponsors. A Blender market is almost going to 10K now, but we also have income via Valve, the Valve Workshop, and the Valve Store. Last year, we also gave out grants for other developers, like for Dependency Graph, the Viewport Work, MultiView, and BTEX. So if you want to join the Blender Development Fund, Google Blender Development Fund, and you get to the page straight away and try to support us. So we did another open movie. Cosmos Laundromat was launched 2 months ago at SIGGRAPH. We had a blast over there. It was really, really positive feedback from especially people from studios. The people who know how painful it is to make hair move or to have grass working and have the light working and animation and the flock and all those things. So those things, we've been trying to push the barrier for Blender, and the quality of the visuals has really put Blender on the radar. We've been having an award, for example, the Digital Production Magazine in Germany awarded Blender with a jury prize. But you can find it everywhere now. Blender is taken seriously, and that's important. Another one is Glass Half. This one is a short cartoon made entirely or rendered in the viewport. And the premiere will be tonight or at the end of the Susanna Award screening. So in the Blender Institute, we want to keep making short film. And the short film production is not only the goal, because it's the means, again, to get development of Blender tested and to get income from Blender Institute so people can get hired. Because the Blender Institute business at the moment, even though we do sell some DVDs and books, is mostly coming from Blender Cloud. The Blender Cloud is the replacement for the DVD business, basically. Because why would you buy a DVD with a training or with the data of a movie if you can get everything online, right? I'm not putting DVDs anymore on my computer. It's too clumsy. So I'm even Googling for my own data to get stuff instead of walking to the closet and get a DVD out of it. So that's the Blender Cloud. And Blender Cloud is meant to be a number of things. So one, it's our open production platform. we create stuff and we give people insight in how it's being made. But I think that many people like to learn by example. They have the skills and they know how things work, but they want to look under the hood of a bigger production. Like, how did they solve all those problems? That's what we try to do in Blender Cloud. But we also have the training still, and of course all the assets of the open movies. Currently there's 1,800 subscribers, which keeps our business alive, but we still need this to be growing. And we hope to do that, for example, by allowing people to start their own projects. We will be running out project management tools. But in a future, as soon as possible, I hope, we should be able to allow people also to store stuff and have versioning and hook it up with render services. We should also talk about making the second episode of Cosmos Laundromat. But people should also realize that episode one costed over 400,000 euros to make it. We had 12 to 16 people working on it for almost a year. That's what it cost to make high quality. For the second episode, we have already stuff prepared, so it won't be that expensive. But I would like to get a very, very strong signal from out there that people want us to make it. So we want to have 4,000 subscribers in Blender Cloud. When that happens, we immediately get in production for the second episode. So the Blender Cloud has a new release coming. It is somewhere in a browser here. Let's see. Yep. So this is how it will look at the moment. So things, there's something bouncing. Who wants my attention? Stupid Adobe. So the cloud has been rewritten using Attract, which is our Blender Institute shot management system. And the shot management system gives you access to the data of our past projects, of the training, and which also now will give you access to talk about stuff, discuss things, and start threads about things so you can have more interaction with our users. This demo, you can see the URL, you can secretly sneak, right? You can look at it, no? For people who want to, I'm not going into detail here because this is still 89% finished, but the last 11% is still in work. So we will see it next week announced. Then we are doing something else, and that is also trying to get the Blender Institute's team to keep them on board. I have really, really, really good people on board, and we would like to have them to stay so they can grow and they can develop, and together we can make bigger things. So one of the ways to do this is by also working on a commercial film. Of course, everything done in Blender and with open source, yeah, that's part of the DNA of the Blender Studio. But we could try to make a film which could be targeted at commercial release in theaters and TV, and et cetera. So I have the rights for the Dutch comic person. This is the Agent 327. He's a Dutch secret agent. That means he has no money, there's no budget. He does not have a license to kill, so he has to shoot around things. It's a very funny cartoon about a secret agent who still rescues the world, but he doesn't get the appreciation for it by the Dutch people, of course. That's how it goes. Okay, my last slide, the Blender conference notes. Everybody has a badge. You have to put it on. It looks very nerdy and not cool. I know people like to put it here or somewhere else or hide it. But this is a little bit our own security as well. If you have a badge, it means that you paid and you can put your bag here and those things don't get lost. We did have once a computer disappearing here, but given the fact that this is already number 14th conference, usually it's very safe. But we want everybody to help looking out as well. And there are some badly employees walking around who don't have a badge, but if you want to walk around here, you should have a badge. If you see people taking bags away, you can see, do they have a thing or not? And then you know if it's a conference visitor. We have a mobile app with the whole program. Go to blender.org/conference for the things to be working there, including announcements if there is something in the schedule which is changing. I had one mail of a person who didn't know yet if it would be showing up, but I think for 100% we still have all the speakers confirmed. We have awesome booklets here. The printer said that the minimum print was 1,000, and we only needed half of that. So I would like to tell everybody to take two.
What?
So you can take one, because in the back there is this really nice do-it-yourself 3D modeling paper. This will make you a nice twin. So give it to your kids, or you can also do it yourself. It's a great way of 3D modeling. There's lunch every day. It starts usually at 12. It goes on at least until 1:30 or maybe even later. The lunch is served in the cafe, downstairs and upstairs. Just walk in and take whatever you like. Speakers, people who are talking at the conference, if you need assistance, you can always talk to me or to Piotr. Can Piotr stand up? It's Piotr. Olivier. Olivier somewhere. Or we also have Thomas. Yeah? And we have a new one, is Helene. Helen, she's also helping out. So those people will be standing, sitting in the front when you have a talk. And when it takes too long, they will say, move on, because we really try to stick to our very tight schedule here. The talk should be lasting 20 minutes, 25 minutes. Oh my God, I'm already past, so stop. So we shouldn't talk too long. So yes, tonight there is a festival screenings, and we have a really, really full house in this conference. But that we have two screenings, so half of the people should go to the first, and the other half should go to the second screening. Usually everybody thinks, okay, I'm going to the first. So now everybody should be thinking, I'm going to the second, right? Or half of the people should be thinking that. So, but I think the first one is probably too full, and like today, we will not have people sitting on the stairs here, which is because of fire security regulations, bureaucracy, I know, but for safety it's important that there are not too many people in one room. If the ceiling falls down, then we can all still get out, right? Yeah. So Saturday is the open stage, also Oliver is organizing it. If you want to have your 5 minutes of fame, talk to Oliver. You can wave again, or there. And get, you have a full program already, or you need more people? Good. So, and then don't forget that Sunday is daylight saving. So we have 1 hour extra. You can sleep 1 hour extra, party 1 hour extra, whatever you want. But if the program starts at 10 in daylight saving time, so don't be here too soon. And of course, have lots of fun. Thank you.